Good evening, everybody. Thanks for letting me come into your home tonight. We're excited to be with you. How about Sunday, huh? For those of you who were able to be there on Sunday, what a great time it was there in the parking lot. And let me commend you. You all did very, very good with all the guidelines we gave. But it was just really good to see everybody. It kind of makes me yearn for the times when we can come back together and enjoy a full service altogether. On that note, we're still kind of just waiting. It seems like things are coming to an end in certain instances where they're at least talking about churches coming back together. So we should be hearing something pretty quick here. And we're, like I say, taking our cue from our government officials. So we're excited that it's coming to an end, but just let me say what an awesome experience it has been for all of us. It isn't all bad. We've learned some very important things. We've learned a lot about ourselves and how we feel towards one another. It was just a joy to watch everybody, just so excited to see everybody on Sunday. But tonight we want to continue our study in 2 Timothy. We're in chapter 2. If you remember last week, we did the first 13 verses of chapter 2. So I want to pick it up from verse 14 through 26 tonight. And before I do that, I want to pray. Father, thank you for your word. And thank you that there is power and authority in your word. Such great instruction that you give us through your word. So Lord, tonight as we hear your word and we ingest the word of God into our life, into our heart, into our spirit, oh God, that it will change us and it will change us forever. Thank you, Lord, for who you are. We love you, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, tonight we want to talk about how to deal with what is false. How to deal with what is false. In verse 14, let me go there and we'll read that. It says, remind everyone about these things. Now, you say, well, what things? Well, in verse 13, we talked about some things, and I'll read that in just a moment. But Paul says to Timothy, remind everyone about these things and command them in God's presence to stop fighting over words. Such arguments are useless, and they can ruin those who hear them. So remind everyone about what? Well, let's go back to verse, I believe it was 11, verse 11 through 13. Paul says to Timothy, if you remember last week, he says, this is a trustworthy saying. Now listen to what he's saying is trustworthy. He says, if we die with him, we will also live with him. How many know that we need to die to ourselves every day? We need to die to the flesh. We need to give our lives over to the Spirit of God and die to the flesh. So if we die with him, we will live with him. If we endure hardship, we will reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we are unfaithful, he remains faithful. God always remains faithful, for he cannot deny who he is. God is a faithful God. So now he says to the believers, he says, he wants to remind them about these true words. Paul wrote those words so that the church would. Now, as I said last week, that was probably a poem or a song that had been circulating through the church for many years. Those who die with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure hardship, we will reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we are unfaithful, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny who he is. So those are the words that Paul is saying to be reminded of. Now, like I say, although that may have been a poem or a song, it was truthful about Christ. It was truthful about the good news of the gospel. So basically, I feel like what Paul is saying here is so important to stick to the truth. Don't get involved in these other arguments that are taking place. He was speaking that very, very strongly to the church in Ephesus. And I think he would say the same thing today if he would not only, and I'm not saying we argue at Northgate, but any church that finds themselves dealing with silly, silly arguments, you need to stop that. He says, stick to the truth. Stick to what you know. There were some in the church at that time who just absolutely loved to argue. And they were arguing over words, semantics, things like that. Paul says it's a waste of time. It's a waste of effort. To fight about things like that has absolutely no lasting value. No lasting value. You're just spinning your wheels. You're spinning in circles. However you want to say that. In other words, stick to the truth. What is the truth? God is faithful. His son Jesus died on the cross. He was resurrected. Those are the things we know to be true. And arguments like these can easily be the cause of many splits in church, and they have been throughout the years. They can also damage some people who want to remain faithful to the things of God. And some of these people are brand new believers, and they watch people arguing, it will turn them sour on the gospel, and we don't ever want that to happen. So to the church in Ephesus, this thing about arguing has become a very, very serious matter. And Paul urges Timothy to remind everyone, no arguments and no fighting. Now we need to keep in mind that there were those in the church who were actually speaking false doctrine. They were speaking false doctrine. Anything concerning Christ, they were speaking false. And Paul says, and someday they're going to have to give an account to God. Let's look at verse 15 here. Work hard so you can present yourself to God and receive his approval. Be a good worker. You know, last week we talked about an athlete, a soldier, an athlete, and a farmer. Now he's saying to the people of Ephesus, be a good worker. Work for the things that please God. Be a good worker, one who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly explains the word of God. So it in contrast to the kind of living that Paul was addressing, basically what he's saying is, hey folks, do your best to please God. And isn't that what we want to do? We want to please God. I know before I lay my head on my pillow at night, I often think, God, was I pleasing to you today? Did I make you smile today? And so we need to work hard to please God and not please other people. If you have to be a people pleaser, you need to spend some time with the Lord and the power of the Holy Spirit and say, God, I don't really care about pleasing anyone else. I care more about pleasing you than anything else. See, believers like us, we are servants of God. And we should do things that are going to please God. So if you're at work, you're working hard and you're wanting to please your employer or your boss or whatever, that's good. But more importantly than anything else, you want to please God. You want to please God in everything that you do. Paul says in some of his writings, he says, work as if you were working for the Lord himself. And so we should do things that will please God. We should be a workman who will never, ever be ashamed of our stance with the gospel. We should concentrate on doing our very, very best for God. I think the best way to do this is to stay away from what I consider pious talk. In other words, does your talk match your walk? Is what you say the way you live? Are you the same at home as you are at church? Those types of things. Let your talk match your walk. I should say it like this: our words must be backed by a godly lifestyle. So it's all about our character. In verse 17, Paul goes on to give names. He goes on to give names that of people that are spreading poisonous stuff, false doctrine. These two names he gives, they're Hymenaeus and Philetus. And these two guys, what they have done, it's as though they are spreading a disease throughout the church. And it has eaten away at the minds and hearts of believers. Those who have accepted these false teachings, it's just corrupted them. And Paul gives a very strong word against these two men. They have actually turned, and they themselves have actually turned from the truth. They teach many things that are not true, Paul says. And let me give you an example, such as, and Paul mentions this, about the resurrection of the dead, that it's already passed. This is what they're teaching. The resurrection of the dead has already happened. This was one of the ways that they used to turn believers from the truth. So if the resurrection of the saints has already happened, what's the point of following Christ? What's the point? And so Paul taught that the resurrection was still in the future and that the Lord was going to come again and he was going to raise those who were dead in Christ. They would be raised again. We call that the rapture, and where he's going to come and take the church. So Paul taught that the resurrection was still in the future. These guys were saying it's already happened. They thought that when they believed, that's when they came to life again, and that's when the resurrection happened. So they were leading people astray. They did not believe that God would raise people back to life again, those who were dead in Christ. So after warning about false teachers, Paul is saying, I just want you to come back to the truth. Okay, you're dealing with people who are preaching falsehoods, but I want to steer you back to what is true. I want to look at verse 19 here. It says, but God's truth stands firm like a foundation stone with this inscription on it. The Lord knows those who are his, and all who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. In other words, there is a firm basis for our faith. And it's in contrast to what these false teachers were teaching. it's in contrast for what they are wanting you to believe. The truth is that the foundation of God is the true church. It's the people of God. It's the believers. They are the foundation. And they are an example of a great foundation. And they're based, and it's all based on the Lord Jesus Christ. And basically what he's saying is that this foundation that we talk about, that we speak about, it's firm. It's as firm as ever. Our foundation in Christ is firm. I'm reminded what Jesus was talking about in Matthew chapter 16 when he came to his disciples and he says, "Who do men say that I am?" And they went on to say, you know, some say you're John the Baptist, some say you're Elijah, some say you're just another prophet. And Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" And it was Peter. He says, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus tells him, "Flesh and blood didn't tell you that, but my Father which is in heaven told you that." And he said, "Peter, upon this rock I will build my church. Upon this foundation I will build my church." Folks, we need to understand that because of our confession and our belief in Jesus Christ and for the asking of the forgiveness of our sins, we stand on a firm foundation. That's why I said earlier that our foundation is as firm as ever. And it was not uncommon for sayings to be written on foundations of walls and buildings at that time. And this obviously was on the, maybe it was on a wall, maybe it was on the church there in Ephesus. It says, "All who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil." Because the Lord knows all who are his. Then he says, "All who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil." So it was customary, like I say, to write those types of things on the foundation of a building. And they would write it on the foundation because they believed that their foundation was firm. Basically, what they're saying is, listen, the true church will never fail. Now, we know that the church is not a building. The church is people. People who have a relationship with Jesus. People who are filled with the Spirit. And that will last forever. That will never fail. That will never, ever fail. The true church. Let's look at verses 20 and 21. Paul now, he gives an example of a rich man's house. And he says, well, let me read it to you. Verses 20 and 21. "In a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver, and some are made of wood and clay. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions, and the cheap ones are for everyday use. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you will be ready for the Master to use you for every good work." You can see how he's turning them from those who are teaching false. He's turning them to reaching out to doing the best you can for God and being the best you can to do the kind of work that he has called you. He says it's just like you go into a house and you see items that are made of gold and silver and they're good. They're those utensils. They may be a knife and fork and serving spoon or something. Maybe they've been around a long time and they're for good use. You take them out to serve people who you really enjoy. You know, if you come to my house, my wife will get out plastic for, no, I'm just kidding. But that's the difference that there are those, now plastic works. I'm not against plastic. I use it quite often, but there's a difference between things that are made for a noble use and things that are made for a non-noble use. So Paul gives an example of this rich man's house, and he says that in the house there are items of gold and silver. And there are also, he says, cheaper materials. There's things like wood and clay, and today it'd be plastic, you know. But each of them would have their uses. They would have their purpose. So among the people of God, the church, there is such a variety of gifting. There is such a variety of people. And not everyone has the same work to do for the Lord. Not every one of us have the same giftings. We are all different, and God has gifted us in different ways. But each of us should be ready to do whatever it is that the Master has called us to do. There are times you'll be able to be used in a way where you can say, whew, I'm gold and silver here. And then there's other times where you're just down dirty in the midst of a situation, and it's difficult and it's hard, and you're a wood or a clay pot or something like that, and it still works. But God wants to use you however you apply yourself. So some of the tasks, they seem better than others, but the tasks that seem less appealing are just as important. Okay, so don't feel like, well, I don't feel like I'm silver or I'm gold or whatever, but you're just as important. You really are. Now, in verse 22, let's go there. Paul kind of makes a turn here a little bit. He says, run from anything that stimulates youthful lust. Instead, pursue righteous living, faithfulness, pursue love and peace. Enjoy the companionship of those who call on the Lord with pure hearts. You know, Paul was a young man. Back then, 30 to 40 was probably the age range that I said Timothy was a young man. And Paul calls him his son. Timothy was probably somewhere between 30 and 40. But Paul urges Timothy to run away from wrong desires. Run away from wrong desires. Go the opposite direction. If there's something that you're involved in, and maybe it was something in your past and it's creeping back up on you and it wants to get you back involved in that thing again, make a U-turn and go the other direction. If you have to, run away from those things. They are apparently desires. What Paul's talking about here, they are apparently desires that are probably stronger in young people. And Paul doesn't say what he meant by youthful desires or lusts. He doesn't say that. We can just surmise. I mean, it could be a selfish ambition. It could be a lack of patience. Or it could be an urge for wrong sex. And so it could be any of those things. So Paul urges him, when you're confronted with any of that, turn and go the other way. Why? Because you belong to God. You're a child of the living God. And God wants to use you for very, very noble purposes. And he wants you to keep your life clean. So you know, run away from those wrong desires. It seems that Paul may have realized that he was talking to a young man in the faith, and maybe Timothy had some weak spots. We're not sure. So he tells him to run from those things. And, you know, I think even today, that's good advice for us today. I would say, as a pastor, I've said to many young people throughout my years of ministry, just turn and go the other way. Desire that's not going to be your life anymore or ever. And your desire is to serve God with all of your heart. But even more importantly now, instead of pursuing wrong desires, how about pursuing the good things? How about going after those things that are good? Be eager to go after those things that are right in your life. You know, much of life, and I believe this, much of life just basically comes down, or simply comes down, to do what's right as opposed to what is wrong. Right and wrong. And if you find yourself in a gray area and you're not really sure, that's when you stop and you ask the Holy Spirit to give you guidance here. He promised to come along and guide us and to be our comforter. And so if you find yourself even in gray areas, you don't know if it's black or white, you just say it's kind of gray and I'm not sure, that's when the Holy Spirit will come in and will help you to discern which way to go. So you need to do the things that God is requiring of you. What is God saying to you? You need to desire to please God. That should be your desire. Not just run away from evil things, but run towards the good things of God. In other words, things like learn to trust God. Put your confidence in God. Love God, love others. Be at peace with people. Those are all good things, and we need to pursue those things. Once again, in verse 23, Paul reminds them to refuse to argue with those who question the truth. Although Christians are servants of the Lord, it seems like Paul here is talking right to Timothy because he's a leader, and he's talking to leadership in the church such as Timothy. Verses 24 and 25. Now we're going to talk a little bit about how to bring correction to people. The servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but must be kind to everyone, be able to teach, and be patient with difficult people. I'm going to say that again. Be patient with difficult people. Gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Perhaps God will change those people's hearts, and they will learn the truth. Then they will come to their senses, and they will escape from the devil's trap, for they have been held captive by him to do whatever he wants. It was about 6 months ago. I was at the church, and it was on a Friday morning, Friday afternoon, and on Fridays I'm there by myself. And some young man came to the door. He says, "You know, I drive by this church all the time, and I just kind of wanted to stop in and kind of check it out and see what you guys believe." So we sat in the foyer there and just talked for a bit. He started asking questions about some of our doctrinal points and what it is we believe. And I was able to answer them. And then he got started on women in ministry. And let me just say, he wasn't a fan of women being in ministry. So he wanted some examples, and I gave him some examples of why we believe women need to be a part of the ministry just like men, and as much as men. I'm telling you, I saw something change in him. He was a nice young man to begin with, but all of a sudden there came this argumentative spirit in him, and he wanted to argue. And I could feel myself just wanting to defend what I believe was so true. And I remember this scripture. When Paul urges Timothy to gently and kindly deal with them, so that they, you know, I didn't want to get into an argument, and I wasn't going to. And I said to him, "You know what? Of course, we don't agree on this. We don't believe, but this is not something I'm going to argue with you about. And you're going to have to let the Lord deal with you. You're going to have to let the Holy Spirit deal with you about what is true." Because I could tell that in some ways he was searching for truth, but there was this argumentative spirit that I was not going to be a part of. I stood up. He stood up. I shook his hand and said, "I'm glad to meet you and glad to know you." And I've never seen him since, but I wasn't about to get into that. And that's not something I dwelt on afterwards or anything like that. I prayed for him, but I felt like I was real gentle and patient with him. I think we need to learn to be pleasant, even to those who will attack you some way in that way, even how he was doing it. Maybe you're attacked other ways, but we need to learn to be pleasant with those people. Be patient with them. You know, our aim as believers is to help those people find the truth. I mean, you know when someone just kind of turns and all of a sudden you hit a hot button in them, and you came against something that they believe so sincere. But I was just basing it on the word. And that particular young man, every time I'd give him an example, he goes, "Okay, so that's one." And so I'd give another thing. "Okay, that's another one. Are there any more?" So it was just one of those things where he just really wanted to argue. And after a while, I really wanted him to see the Christ-like character that was in me. That's not something I had to argue about. So if you find yourself like that with people who are just wanting to be argumentative, you know what? Turn on the Christ-like character. Let them see Jesus in you. And just maybe, in verse 26, it says, just maybe those who have been deceived will turn from what is false to what is true. And we need to learn to see them not as those who are deceivers, but we need to see them as those who are being deceived. They're not necessarily the deceivers. You know, from time to time, and you know, we all have people come to our doors, or you may see them in the marketplace somewhere, and they're handing out materials. And more times than not, some of those people wanted to come in and just argue doctrinal points with you, you know. And I used to get angry with them. And then I began to realize they weren't the deceivers. They have already been deceived. They have been deceived. And so when I see them that way, I kind of see them how God does. And I begin to pray for them. And hey, listen, I've never shied away from a good debate ever, but there are times when arguing over things like that just really, really have no place in the life of a Christian. And so these are people who have been caught in a trap for a long, long time. And what they need is an encounter with Jesus. They just need an encounter with Jesus. So I say it like this: just kill them with kindness. Just kill them with kindness. Love them into the kingdom of God. Okay? Okay, so that's chapter 2. And I'm excited about chapter 3 next week. And again, Paul's going to be talking to Timothy regarding the dangers of the last days. So once again, so good to be with you. I've enjoyed being in your homes tonight. And I thank God for every one of you. My Northgate family is very, very important to me. And all my friends out there who are watching, you're very, very important to me. We love you so much. So God bless you. Have a great night, and we'll see you soon.